about the object-oriented database. First, let me explain what is the object-oriented database and why we need these things for the managing the database for the organizations. Because when we are performing a complex operations for any organizations, then we have to have such kind of facility in our database. It makes your works easier and perform the operations in a very accurate manner. For example, when we are talking about the complex database systems, for example, like CAD or CAM or CAS or CIEM or GIS kind of system, we need to have such kind of system in place for the organizations. Now, first, let me give one example how it works and what are the components we use in the object-oriented database. The object-oriented database, whenever we are performing any operations in this database management system, we have a kind of data structure, we have the data models, and we are using a different kind of programming language. So we need a kind of structure for the association of the database. So, and in the alignment may. So that makes the object-oriented database different from the traditional database system. The backbone for the object-oriented database is object-oriented paradigm. And what are the components in this paradigm? We will discuss all these paradigm components one by one. First is the object and the object identifier. What we will do whenever we want to perform or whenever we want to use the object-oriented database management system, we will divide the problems into different kind of objects, and object identifier we will allocate for each object. So first we have to understand what is the meaning of an object when we are talking about the database system. Object is a real entity which is having some kind of existence in the system, and it is the real world entity and database objects, so that the object do not lose their integrity and identity. Let me explain one example. When we are talking about the university system, object is an entity, faculty is an entity, the library we can say is also an entity, which is having some kind of existence in the world that makes some kind of uniqueness, that is called the object. And for each object, we will allocate an object identifier to identify whenever we want to perform any kind of operation. The best example, let's say in your class, for each student, we have an object identifier, means your roll number or your enrollment number. Let's say in your class, two students is having the same name, let's say Karthik and Karthik, the same name, and they are in the same class, and I'm teaching one subject, and whenever I'm marking the attendance, how I will recognize? I will recognize through their enrollment number. So here, enrollment number is called an object identifier. The next terminology which we use for the object-oriented paradigm is the encapsulation. And what is the encapsulation? We use the class and object concepts in the object-oriented database. So encapsulation as name itself says, encapsulate. Encapsulation means the wrapping up of our data and methods together is known as encapsulation in object-oriented database system. Now, the next terminology we use in the object-oriented paradigm is called inheritance, and is a very popular technique in the managing the object-oriented database. What is inheritance? Inherit the property from the base class. For example, when we are talking about some software or database, let's say we have Microsoft Windows 10 we are using. So Microsoft 10 Windows is having some features from Windows 8. It inherits some properties from Windows 8 and some additional facilities added in Windows 10. And the company Microsoft launched the new product in the market. So this is called inheritance. In our real life, let's say a child is having some features from his parents. The features comes through the inherit property. So here we use the base class and the child class. The base class is the main class, and the child class is having some features from the base class. So that denotes about the inheritance. What is the benefit of inheritance in object-oriented database design? The main benefit of the inheritance in the object-oriented database is the reusability facility. Let's say we define a class, or we define some objects and method, because this will take some time. And we want to perform another module for an application. So we can use that object, class, and method for another method or another function, because we already defined that one. So there is no need to define in another class or another method, because through the inherit property, we can inherit that attributes of that class, and we can reuse in the another class. So that's the beauty of the inheritance, and which makes it very different from other features. Now, as I've given the example of the different version of Windows 8, Windows 10, or let's say Windows 98. So company launched the new products based on this inheritance concept, and how they will do this thing. For example, now we people are using the Windows 10. Now, the company, those who develop this kind of products, they are getting the feedback from the customer or from the client, and the team, research team, is working for the new things, and they will add the new things in the existing features, and in the coming time they will launch the new product in the market. The same thing is happening with all products. Whenever we are talking about the database application, or whenever we are talking about the Windows version, or whenever we are talking about the manufacturing industry, the car model launching, and all the things. So that's very interesting. Now, the next thing is the object-oriented data model. Object-oriented data model. Whenever we want to use the object-oriented database management system, we have to define a well-defined object-oriented data model in your database. This is the core model based on this concept, which is highlighted on the slides, as you can see, all of you. The first one is the object. As I told you before, that we will first thing for any application implementation, we have to define the object in that application, because that object makes communication with each other and perform any kind of operation in the application. So while choosing this object, we have to know very well what are the properties of object and how we allocate the object identifier. And as per the definition, on object is saying that it must be in a real world entity. Then only we can say, okay, this is an object and this is then unique identifier for that object. Now, the second thing is the instance variable and methods. What is the meaning of this? For example, if I'm talking about a student is having his class, semester, his roll number, his subjects, his teachers, his internship, his projects. So these are called the attributes for that particular object. So we have to define all the attributes and methods in a unique way, and because this will help whenever we want to perform any operation. Let me give an example again for this attribute. Let's say in the banking we have the credit and debit kind of operation. So in the banking database, they use the object-oriented data models, and they use all this concept. Whenever you are performing any operations with the credit, it will go through the credit system. Whenever you are performing any operation with the debit, it will go to the debit method. But they should communicate with each other by the help of an object. So one method is also depend on the another method. So they have to communicate with each other by the help of unique identifier that is called an object. Third one is the object state. The state of an object is assessed or modified by sending message to the object to invoke the corresponding methods, as I have discussed this thing through the banking example. Now, as we discuss that we are defining the classes, we are defining the objects, but let's say we are working on the large application or the large database, and if we have many objects and many classes, that makes difficulty in assessing the data, or whenever the user or the client or manager, they want to assess the data. In that case, what we will do, we will categorize, we will group them. Okay, this is the class for semester 6, and all objects, those belong from semester 6 class, they will go in this class for attending any classes. Those who are in the semester 8, they will go to semester 8 class, because the university management or the department has to prepare the timetable, and we have to manage all the things. Let's say the number of subject and number of students and number of activities in the department. So whenever we want to perform any kind of operations, let's say I want to send a message. If I have a group of a particular class, I can send the message very easily. and it reduces the complexity of your database. So it's a very important the grouping into the same classes. And let me ask you the definition of a class. If I ask you this definition, then as I remember that I have discussed this topic in your class, what is an object and what is the classes. And I got some answers from you guys that class is a collection of similar type of object. And that makes the group of classes. Again, very practical example, we have a class fruit, we have a class vegetable. All the vegetables will come under the class vegetable, and all the fruits will come under the category of the fruit class. Now, the last, and which is very, again, is a very important concepts of OO data model is the specialization feature. Specialization of one or more class. I will discuss this topic in the coming slides, but here I want to mention what is a specialization. A class defined as a specialization is called subclass and inherit the attributes and method from its parent class. For example, a father is having a two child, so father is the main class and father class is having a two child class, class 1 and class 2. So that is basically called a specialization. In banking industry, we have account. Account is the main class. We have a saving account, we have a current account. So saving account and current account is called the subclasses of the parent class, which is the account class. So this is the one of the best example of the specialization feature. In object-oriented database, DBMS that directly support a model based on the object-oriented paradigm. As we discuss all the things, let's say object, class, object identifier, inheritance, these are the basic building blocks of an object-oriented paradigm. Similarly, for object-oriented database management system, we will provide the persistent storage for an object in the descriptor, class and instance schema. As we have discussed in the initially, what is a schema? A schema is basically called overall design of a database is called an schema. Apart from these characteristics, object-oriented database management also include the query language, then optimization of the database, indexing and clustering, concurrency control techniques, and transaction management. Some of these topics we have discussed in our classes. Let's see, in yesterday class, we have discussed about the concurrency control, locking protocol, and other methods. And day before yesterday class, we have discussed about the transaction management also. So that all features utilize when we are defining any object-oriented database for any organizations. And for defining the object-oriented data model, we use a number of graphical notations because, as I mentioned, that we are using the class, object, attributes, inheritance, such kind of features. So we use some standard graphical notations for defining this kind of things in the object-oriented data model. So what are these? We will discuss through one practical example. Here on the screen, as you can see, this is one of the diagram. And here, if you can see in the slide, we have the boxes. And the boxes represent here an object. And the arrow You can see from one arrow to another object, there is an arrow. This arrow represent about the inheritance. And as you can see on the downside, lower bottom of the slide, you can see this description of this symbolic representation for this example. This is an example for a company. In company, we have a number of employees. We have a team. We have a permanent employee. The team is working on some projects, and we have different kind of institutes or departments in the company. And we have the address. So these are the main objects in this problem. Here you can see for a company, we have defined a number of attributes. You can see company name should be the string and the location. Location is denoted through a symbolic representation which goes to the address part. Here, if you remember, we have done some practicals in the programming lab. And as you remember that when we are creating any table, and for table creation, we are using a number of attributes. Whenever you are defining an attributes for a table, we must have to define the attribute type, which kind of data type you are using. For example, like let's say your roll number, you are taking an integer. And we are using where character, we are using the string. Let's say for this example, company name is string, because company name, for example, we have a company name ABC. So ABC is basically a string. Now, then the another objects in a similar way, you can see here, let's say the employee, we have an address, and address we are denoting through the arrow also, because that gives you the detailed information about the address. So that's why the arrow is mentioned. Let's say the address attributes is here, country, city, and number. And similar way, the other attributes is defined for this example. I hope you understand this object-oriented example well. This is the same way which we have discussed about this example. Now, here you can see, this is the design process and object-oriented database schema. We use the conceptual design. And for the conceptual design, we use the UML notation. UML is the acronym for the Unified Modeling Language. And we use the standard design, that's object definition language. And the implementation design is basically our object-oriented database management system. So you can see how this arrow is connected within each other. And this is called object-oriented database schema, which is the overall design for the object-oriented database. This is the conceptual design, how we denote a conceptual design for any problem. And you can see here that we use the specialization features. This is the one of the example where we mentioned the objects and attributes and the specialization features about the students. This is an example of the university database. We have a student, we have the teachers, and we have the participant, and we have a number of programs. And we have defined the attributes. And you can see here that we have mentioned 0 and 1. 0 and 1 means whenever there is a connection, we have mentioned about it. And this denotes about the relationship. If you remember, when we have discussed about the ER diagram, we have discussed about the four kind of relationship: 1-to-1, 1-to-many, many-to-1, and many-to-many. So this also we can use in this conceptual design whenever there is a kind of relationship is there. A standard schema design, which is we have discussed, which is the part of object-oriented database design. Now, here, the object type translation, how we do the translation. Each UML persistent class is translated into an object definition language class, which represent the abstract behavior. Abstract means basically what? The summarized form of that for that class. Here we have the participant and we have these attributes, name, address, and address we have the sub attributes. So you can see here we have defined these numbers with that particular attribute and with that particular data type for this translation. This is association. Association means what kind of relationship we have that comes under the association. How many objects of a class can be associated with a specific object of the related class? It is represented by two numbers that represent the minimum and maximum multiplicity. You can see here we have a student, we have a PhD program, and we have the rank of the, we have the lecturers or the professors in the university, and we have defined this kind of relationship. This is the way how we can denote the associations of an objects and the classes together. This is the descriptions of the generalizations, how we can extend the use. Here we use the class student and we use the class lecturer and we use the participant. Here, if you can see class student extend participant, this is the example of the inheritance. Here extend is the keyword. We are using this class participant and we are using the student class, and we are defining some attributes here. So here you can see that this arrow represent here means one is the base class, another one is called subclass. Means there is no need to define the attributes again because we can use the inherit property and we can reuse that features from that class. That is the practical example how we use inheritance in the object-oriented database design. Now the collections and structure types. We use the dictionary for the collecting the data, and whenever there is a kind of attribute or when we want any kind of data type, we can retrieve from the dictionary. MBAC type, if the collection type allows duplicate and has an unbounded number of elements and the order is not relevant. In that case, we use the collection and the structure data type. For that, we use the different kind of data structure. As we know about the stack, about the queue, about the linked list. So we will define and we will allocate a particular key value. So there is no duplicacy in the database and we can easily and efficiently can retrieve the data. Implementation schema design. We use a number of programming languages for defining the database design. We can use the C++, we can use the Java and any other programming language. So thank you, dear students. And if you have any doubts, we can discuss as far as this object-oriented database management system is concerned. Thank you for your time. If you have any questions, we can discuss.